Helms, Director of Library and Archives here at Reynolda House.
I'm Phil Archer, Director of Public Programs at Reynolda House.
And we're interviewing William Wharton for the Reynolda Oral History Project.
And Mr. Wharton, thank you so much for doing this. We have letters and papers and maps, but what really tells us what life was like is folks that remember and can tell us stories. So thank you for coming and answering some questions.
Well, considered what life was with the other people, we had a good life. We could, any place you wanted to raise a garden, you cleaned it up. And your parents could bring the mules up there and plow it up, raise a garden. They used to kid my dad, says, Reynolda was truck patching and my daddy was farming. Because everything that we wanted, we raised, we canned it, we kept it, and we ate it. Except when somebody come by and didn't need needed something and didn't have nothing. Then we all never so good we couldn't share with them.
Did you like gardening?
Oh, I loved it and still do, but I ain't able.
You like to look?
Huh?
You like to look and enjoy?
Yeah.
Could you tell us where you were born and when?
I was born right up here. 5/21/26.
And by right up here, describe the part of the estate.
Yeah.
Where you were born.
Up there in the house that they built for my daddy. See, my daddy, A.C. Wharton, brought all the Whartons from Clemens over here when he come.
And he was superintendent?
Yeah. And what happened, my daddy didn't like Fibro. So he left, went back to David County to West Johnson and started farming. A.C. didn't want that. He had him to build my daddy a house. He come over there and moved my daddy back over here. Now, my daddy had two children born over there. That was James and Howard. The rest of us was born right here when Reynolda.
And your father's name?
Monroe. Monroe Clinton Wharton.
And so it's the same Clinton as Albert Clinton Wharton.
Yeah.
So they shared the same middle name.
And your mother's name?
Susie Cuthrell Wharton.
Was she from Clemens?
No, she was from Davie County.
Davie County.
Over at Farmington.
Can you tell us what they did for Reynolda? Can you tell us what your parents did for Reynolda?
My dad drove a team of mules. Back then they didn't have no truck. Well, they did finally have one old truck called an old 14. And but they had mules. I don't mean little mules. They had big mules, big as horses. And from what I learned in these later years, most of them stock come from the Bronx over at Farmington. But they would sidetrack the coal carts down the Reynolda Road. I don't know whether you know about that or not. The train would bring the coal down that Reynolda Road in front of the children home. They would sidetrack them. Then my daddy, Mr. Stimson, I can't think of others, they would all take the mules down there, load the coal on the wagons, and bring the coal back here to the steam plant. You know what a steam plant is?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know all those manhole covers in the road out there? They would open up the manhole covers, drop the coal down in there.
And where were the mules stabled? Do you remember?
Yeah, all of them stabled over there in the big barn.
In the village?
Yeah, my granddaddy, when he come, that was his job, to take care of the mules and the horses. He took care of them until he died. And my daddy, he drove the team. His mule was Mabe and Elizabeth.
He always had the same mules?
Huh?
He always drove the same team?
Yeah. And Mabe and Ruby, that's what his mules. And I didn't know the name of Hubbards and all the rest of them, but time passes and I forgot it. But my mama, she didn't do too much work for Reynolds and the Babcocks. But she did work for different place, different people. And but my daddy, he only worked for Reynolda. That was all.
He retired from Reynolda?
He stayed there until he couldn't work. At first, he drove the mules. My grandfather was a barn keeper. Then when my grandfather died, Lee Hamlin, he took over the job of taking care of the mules. And then when he died, I've been trying to think of that little fellow's name. But I can't think of it. He took over. Then later on, my daddy, they put him over it. And he took care of the mules, the hogs, both. And we had hogs over there.
Quite a number of them.
Yeah. And we had our own hogs too. But he raised the hogs. And what we'd do, they would kill the hogs, bring them down there where the steam plant is. They had a big vat down there where they had the fire and we scalded them. And we cleaned them. And then we brought them up to the smokehouses. The little buildings you see going down that way, that was smokehouses. That's where they hung the meat in. And we clean them, hang them up in there. And that's why I learned to cut up a hog and do butchering.
And how was the meat?
Oh, meat was good. Good fat back, big thick fat back.
I understand that that's one of the things that R.J. Reynolds asked for, that Catherine Reynolds chose most of the things that they grew and the livestock that they grew, but he wanted that kind of hog. He wanted the Tamworth hog because it was so sweet.
Say what?
R.J. Reynolds liked it as well, and he asked for that kind of meat.
Yeah.
That breed.
Oh, yeah. We raised it. And some of those hams that was hanging up in there were being there for maybe 2 years old.
So apart from delivering the coal, what else would the team drivers do?
Oh, Lord, they mowed all the land and worked on the land out in Buena Vista. But most of it was just the work for the mules. Things had to be done. They did it here.
Did he ever mention anything about dredging the lake? Was he involved in creating the lake?
Yeah. The lake itself was built. They didn't use the horses too much on that. But when the lake got to be in my older days, my teenage days, they had what we called a drag line. And they had a fella come by and he would reach out that drag line and pull that stuff out, throw it out, all the way around the lake. And it was a beautiful lake. believe it or not.
What would you do at the lake?
Nothing, because I wish we could fish. Sometime we could slip in and fish. They wouldn't bother us on the upper end up there. Bobby Conrad got a little older. I would come down some Saturdays, and his mama and me would go out there in front of the boathouse and fish. They would let me fish that with them.
Did you swim? Was it?
We had a swimming pool on the lower end. Swimming pool still there, and what I done washed away.
Below the fall.
Yeah. Uh-huh. That was a big swimming pool, and we swam there all the time.
All the kids on the estate?
If they wanted to swim, they could swim.
What was your first job here?
My first job? Working in the garden. If you wanted to work, they would find something for you to do. I was working up there $1 a day, 50 cents on half a day Saturday. And they called my name out with all the rest of them. The post office sat in the middle up here. They moved the post office back. And in the back of the post office, that's where they would pay off at. We'd line up around the back. And then when I got a little older, my dad would always, on Saturday, after we get paid off, as usual back in them days, we would go shopping. Hoosier and Moses down on Trace Street, where we'd go get our flour and sugar, because everything else we raised, we didn't need it. And Mr. Moser, because I was so poor and skinny, he called me Shotgun. And I was trying to sell candy for the school, and he didn't like it. Those little, what you call, bars with stripes in it. He called Hoosier, told him to bring him a carton of cigarettes up there. I mean, a case of cigarettes, not a carton. Cut that in half. Took the cigarettes out. He put me 2 cartons of Camels. They were selling for 15 cents a pack. Y'all wouldn't know about that. A pack of Avalon's, 10 cents a pack. I mean, a carton of Avalon, 10 cents a pack. Carton of Chesterfield, 10 cents a pack. Pall Mall's, 10 cents a pack. Put them in there. He gave me a box of Mr. Good bars. 5 cents a bar. Baby Ruth, 5 cents a bar. Butterfingers, 5 cents a bar. Put them in there. And he told my daddy, said, all right, take these home for Shotgun. And my daddy had a fit. I can't pay for nothing like that. He said, you ain't got nothing to do with this. He said, Shotgun, here's a book. So if they ain't got money, let them write it down. Everything. And then when they go get their check, you be down there and collect your money.
So you became the traveling salesman?
So every morning, 10 o'clock, I would get up. I wasn't working there. Take my cigarettes and run all over the place. I even come down here. Some of the people was out there working on the golf course. That was the first golf course around here. 9 holes, you know. They'd write the name down. Come Saturday, they start paying off, I'd be down there. So Steve Wanigan, he was head guy here then. He wanted to know, what's going on out there? So all of them going over there around that boy. So he come out to see, and my daddy liked to have a fit. Because he didn't know what he was going to say about it. He stopped them from paying off. He said, hold it, I don't want nobody move. He said, just stay and listen to what I got to say. He said, this boy's out here trying to give y'all cigarettes and candy. Says, if either one of you mistreat him or don't pay him, you can get up the road. He said, now y'all can pay off. He went on back in the building. I got everybody paying me the whole time except one. One boy decided he wasn't going to pay me. Charles, can't think of his last name. But anyway, he wasn't going to pay me. He didn't pay me. Monday morning, when time for him to go to work, I told him, well, you ain't got no job. You need to get up the road. And that wasn't the only thing. He turned around and told his daddy, I don't want him out here on Reynolda no more. He's wiped out of Reynolda.
But you weren't allowed to sell Philip Morris cigarettes, right?
Huh?
It had to be Reynolds cigarettes. It had to be Reynolds cigarettes?
No. Pall Mall and Chesterfield's, all them, they weren't Reynolds.
What would you do with the spending money that you made?
I'd have to carry it and give it to my mama and my daddy. And come to find out, I was making more money selling candy and cigarettes than my daddy was making working. He was only making $12 a week, and I'm bringing in sometimes $15, $18, $20.
What would you do in the gardens, and who did you work for?
When I was in the garden.
When you were in the gardens.
I worked for Walt Martin, and his daddy had just passed. And him and his daddy was the head gardeners.
Is his daddy Frederick? Was he English? An Englishman who died in?
I don't remember that now.
Okay. Because the gardener was died in World War I.
Yeah. But Walt and myself, we was down there, and we didn't have tillers and things then. We had to do it with spades. And I could go down there and show you how we spade it and turn it over. But that's where I worked. And then when I got a little older, I was talking to Mr. Conrad. Asked him a dollar a day, you know, if it's on Saturday. I said, my, that's a little more money. He told me if I could better my condition to go do it. He wouldn't hold it against me. I left, went to Norfolk, in the Navy Yard, because I was a teenager then. I took some schooling in machinists. And I went to the Navy Yard. I wanted to be a machinist, go in the machine shop and run the lathes and the those machines, but they sent me out there putting up elevators.
Where did you study to become a machinist?
Over at Atkins High School. That's where I took it. C.I. Sawyer was teaching. We'd go over that night, take that up. And they put me with the elevator people. Elevator was good, but you putting up rails for the elevator, they up over you, laying cement blocks with cement falling down. Yeah. And some hit me in the face. Well, they sent me up home for about 3 days. They sent me on to the hospital and cleaned it out. Didn't do no damage. 3 days and I went back. Well, we don't need him in the elevator. We'll put him in a testing lens for goggles. So I was testing goggles, lids, and I was breaking glass everywhere. Well, that's what they told me they wanted me to do. Well, but I still couldn't get in the machine shop. So I said, well, safe for me. I'm getting old now. Ain't gonna be long before I'm gonna have to go in Harley. I come back home and went to the railroad. But I still lived here on Reynolda.
And worked for the railroad?
Yeah. I still lived out there with my mom and him. And I worked for Southern. Called me in the Army. I went in the Army. 44. And '46, it was all over. '45, we was on the boat getting ready to invade Japan. War ended. We celebrated on the boat going in. Went to there. But then soon as I was able, I come back. I was going to stay over there in civilian occupation. But my mom had wrote and said they had to make my daddy quit work. Says his blood vessel going to his heart was enlarged and they wasn't expecting to live. So quite natural. I come home to take care of him. I wasn't looking for my brothers and all of them. She wrote me and told me she wanted me home. I come home. And I stayed with him and took care of him all the way up until they was doing away with Reynolda. I was sitting on the porch looking at, what was his name, Trubert, when he come down, going over there, opening the ground for Wake Forest. They come right by my house. You know what a water tank is?
The water tank out on Reynolda Coliseum?
No. Coming down into Wake Forest.
Is it along the stream in the woods?
Yeah, something in the woods there. Uh-huh. Going right down there. Our house was right below it. And when they come down after them. So they said they was going to have to do away with the house and everything. My mama didn't want to move to Winston. She said that wasn't no fit place to live. My Uncle Ab, he got his house over there on Rundale. Buck, he was the chef.
Driver.
He was over on Gray Avenue. I could tell you a whole lot about that, but I don't want it on camera. And all of them got placed. So I found a house over there at Farmington, and I moved them over there. Started them building our house. They would frame it up, put the rafters on it. She didn't like the way they put the rafters on. When they leave, she'd get up there and tear them off. That was my mama. And ain't no need of nobody saying it didn't, because I saved some of them in the attic over there now so that they can see them. And so finally, I went over there and fired everybody. And I got a book, How to Build a Better Home. And there was an old man over there, John James, asked him to show me how to come cut a rafter for me. So I ain't gonna come cut no rafter for you. So you go down to Hangle Bookstore and get a book called The Steel Square. And you come back when you get it and let me see it. So quite natural. I'm flying over there. See, I was working in Reynolds at night then. I go to Hangle Bookstore, get the book, carry it down there to it. He said, now bring me a piece of lumber about so big. Bring your steel square with you and a pencil. I carried it down there. He had me to look in the book, see how to cut a rafter. He said, now put your square out. I don't know about putting no square on it. He said, that's what I'm gonna make you do. He showed me how to put it on there, mark it. Then he fixed it over here, mark it. He said, now, you say this, this is your powder. I laid those pieces down, went home, got the lumber, and cut the powder. In the meantime, well, Mama didn't like what they was doing. When they got the studs up, they were putting the rafters on the studs. But according to the blueprint, they had to put another set of studs up 4 foot high. And then the rafters went on it. And me and my mama put them up, cut the rafters, built the house, and they moved in.
How old was your mother?
Oh, she had some age on her. But she was a worker. And she didn't allow us to say can't. The word can't wasn't to be used in her house. If you use can't, you could expect a backhand lick. And most of the time it was in the kitchen and she was washing dishes.
Well, it seems like as a boy you did so many different things.
Huh?
As a boy you did so many different things, so many different kinds of work. Can you tell us about Five Row and what school was like and what you learned?
Well, this is something you won't let nobody tell you. But Five Row, when they do it away with it, I was building my house. I had built Mama's. I was building my house. I come over, Wanakin had left and gone back to New York. Lindsay Sapp was the head man there. So I told him I wanted one of them houses. He sold it to me. And this is a thing you won't believe. When I tore that house down, every two before on it had things on the end. You got like they got now. And guess where it was bought from? Sears and Roebuck.
Really?
Sears and Roebuck.
Was it a kit house?
I don't know what it was. That was for my time. But I know one thing, there was good two befores, and you know what? They're still standing in that house I built.
So, and this was in Farmington?
Farmington. But the houses that I tore down there, all the lumber on all the two befores has Sierra Roebuck things stamped on the end of them. Now you go out Lowe's in different places and look at the two befores now, you'll see it on the end of them, a little bit of step where it was bought at. All of them had Seal and Roebuck.
Now I've read that Mr. Babcock helped people that wanted to move their houses out of Five Row.
Yeah.
Is that so?
I don't know about that part, but I do know one thing. When I come and told myself that I was building my house, because he knew I'd already built my mama's, and he was well satisfied with how I was taking care of my daddy. And he sold me that house. Once, nothing, just enough to say I bought it. And I tore it down and I moved it over there. I had my oldest son, he lives with me now, taking care of me. He was there helping me tear it down. And he swore he saw a horse in a tree. If you see him now, he'll tell you the same thing. He's 60-something years old. He said, yeah, that horse was in that tree. A big tree, big cedar, a pine tree was there in front of the house. And he says, he saw that horse in that tree. And every time we'd be over there, He would try to show us that horse. I couldn't see him. He said, Daddy, there he is. That horse is up there.
And why do you think he was seeing a horse in the tree? Why did he see a horse in the tree?
I don't know. But he said it was in the tree.
Did he become an artist or a poet or something?
No.
He had imagination.
He wasn't particular about going back over there. But he couldn't sit out there by himself, so he went with us.
Do you remember how much you paid for the house?
It was, might have been $25. It wasn't much. I just remember. But it wasn't much. What he wanted to do was say, I bought it. They didn't give it to me. If anything happened to me while I tore it down, Reynolda wasn't responsible because they sold me the house.
How many houses are still in existence, do you think, that were moved off of Five Row?
I don't know of any.
Because the church was moved out to Piney Grove and it was totally changed.
Yeah. They tore it down, moved it out there. But I can't tell you about the houses. I've got stuff. Big map of the ground layout, so I can show you a lot of stuff there. Where the bird pens was. Nobody, when I spoke about the bird pens, one fellow said he didn't know it was anything but bird pens. Dick Runnels had the things he wanted here at Reynolda. That was before it was divided up and Babcock got this part. When Babcock got this part, the birds that he didn't turn loose, he took them up to Long Creek Lodge Devotion. My son, my brother, oldest brother, and my neck oldest brother, he carried them with him because they was taking care of the bird pens. And James, he took him and his private valet. Clint, he put him in the kitchen with Maggie Duffy. He was a cook. And that's where they stayed until World War II. When World War II came, he went and volunteered for the Navy. He was teaching my oldest brother, James. He had him taking lessons how to fly an old big stencil plane. Buck was the chauffeur. He was teaching James how to fly that plane. But when the war came, he gave the plane to the Navy. He went in the Navy. And of course, quite natural, my brother James, he had to go in the Army because he went in the Navy. He goes and volunteered for the Army. Clint, he come on back down home. He went to work for Tom Rice, who lives across the road. And after he moved, went to work for him. He stayed there. I was in the Navy, I was in the Army then. Next thing I know, they said they had drafted Clint into the Navy. But it was something out here. We had our baseball team. You know, we had a baseball field over there, across the road, behind the church back over there. We had a, oh God, I can't think of anything, recreation that they come up with, we had it here on Reynolda. Some of them might have told you all about that.
Did you golf?
Huh?
Did you golf? Were you interested in golfing?
Well, if they had wanted it, some of them would get out here on the thing and play a little while, but most of them did more caddying and watching them play.
Were you too young to see Dick and Smith, I guess you were too young to see Smith flying airplanes and building a plane on the property?
Yeah. I was little, real small, but yeah, I would see it. And yeah. They had one of his engines was down there in the old dairy part after the dairy was closed up. You know, I don't know who it was, but one of them gave it to my brother. Four sold them, and it laid around over there. I carried it over to books, ain't any of them. Gray Avenue. And I never did go back to get it. When she died, I don't know what they did with it. I wasn't even interested. Yeah, I was little, but we would be out. And when they'd have something big going on here, my daddy would be the watchman on the upper gate. This was known as the upper gate. That was known as the bank gate. Down there where the post office was. But when anything big was going on, they'd have my daddy up here on this upper gate.
Did you get to know the Badcocks well when they were here?
Well, I had gone after that. I moved on away. Yep, I knew them, not too well, but Charles, the boy, when he was little, 1 week, he come down there and worked in the garden with us. Or when he went to get his check, they called his name. He was a tough guy. When they got his check, come out strutting. But he was down there with me and Walt. Walt Martin, Mr. Martin. Then I left, and then Walt left and went across the road over there, running the store for Dave Martin. I don't know who took over the garden after that. But I enjoyed the garden because anything that would do me any good, man, Walt would teach me. I can go out here and graft trees as good as anybody. Yeah, root plants. I guess I haven't done it in 2 years, but I've been sick, I couldn't. But before them 2 years come, I could do anything like that I wanted. Didn't have no trouble.
How did you walk to work? What was your way to get to work, to the gardens?
Walk.
Through the woods, by the lake, around the lake?
If I didn't get up and come ride with my daddy. My daddy, he'd ride. He'd drive down and park out there. And we'd get out, come up in the garden, wherever I wanted to go. He was very strict. If you had to do something, something needed to be doing, he would see to it that you done it, and you better do it right.
Sounds like your mother as well.
You better believe it.
Would your friends from town come visit you out here, or were most of your friends other people that lived out here?
Well, I had a few would come out of town to visit us, and my uncle, Eric Eagles, he married my daddy's sister. They was always coming from Clemens up here to visit. And we would always have that big cookout whenever they come. He had about 15 children. And my daddy had all of us. But we would have a time.
At the house?
Yeah. Yeah.
When you were younger, did you attend school at Five Room?
Yeah. And I had to learn. Miss Lovey Eaton didn't play. You learned. Because she had a nice room. And she would toughen up your hands. And then when they did away with school there, they moved us to Piney Grove. And Miss Douglas was a teacher up there. Every year, come spring, fall of the year, she had an old Dodge. She'd take it and have it tuned up, put a new fan belt on it, and she'd bring that fan belt to school. And you learn. Or you wore that fan belt. And I left there and went to Carver. Yeah. Got ready to go into eighth grade. When I was a little boy, my mama was washing for Miss Hendricks over on First Street. Her husband was a principal over at Skyland School. And I would go, and back then, you know, they didn't have washers and dryers. You washed, you put the clothes in a cast iron pot, and you boiled them, you took them out, you put them back in there, and you scrubbed them again, and then you rinsed them, and you hung them up on the line. And I was a little boy. My mom would take me over there. It was my job to keep that fire going under that wash pot. Now, when I got ready to go to high school, Miss Hendricks told my mama, no, he ain't going over there. Said, Carver, they ain't teaching you no trades. She paid $6 a semester for me to go to Atkins. I would walk from up there where Wake Forest is up to 25th Street and catch the bus to go to Atkins High School. Yeah. They wouldn't even let me ride the county bus up there. That's a fact. But I walked. And an old man that owned the Chrysler place there wants to him and his daughter would be coming down the road and they'd see me. They stopped, put me in the car, put me out at the corner of 25th and Cherry, and they'd go on to work. And I'd catch the bus and go to Atkins. In the evenings, wasn't but a nickel to ride the bus, you know. Ride the school bus back up there, get off, and then I'd walk from up there home. When I got home, I had all my chores to do. But yeah, but over there, they had mechanics, brick mason, painting, and something else, I can't think of what it was, trades. But Miss Hendricks was gonna see to it that I had a trade. And I guess that's what sort of got instilled in me now. I tell every child, learn a trade and learn something new every day. Are you looking at a man here? Old man. Well, I can't say I'm old, I'm seasoned. And just like a ham, you know. I ain't never been out of a job when I was able to work that I wanted to work. Certified mechanic. I can do a machinist. When I come out of the Army, I went to school to be a tailor. I got my sewing machines over to the house now. But I won't sew for a woman. And you can't say I can't leave Rick, because you go out there and look at my house, you'll see the fireplace is built in it. If you look at the house, you see I designed it, and me and that wife back there, and the kids, we built it. And when I say we built it, every nail we put in, every wire for the electricity, we run it. Every bit of the plumbing coming from the well into the house, we put it in there. The only thing that we had help on to do it was pouring the base cement in the basement. That was just a little bit too much for me, and I know she couldn't do it. That was over, 40 years ago.
What did you do in the tobacco company? What was your job at Reynolds?
I drove a forklift for 17 and a half years. Before this, I was in there where they mix up the stuff to put in the tobacco.
When you were growing up, did your parents talk about that as a possible career, just to go from Reynolda to the company?
When I come back here from the Army, the railroad was shutting down. So I went down there, running off at the mouth. And the man says, "You say you want a job, you come over here, I'm gonna give you a job." So I went to work. Wasn't no ifs, ands, and buts. He gave me a job, I went to work.
Apart from the barbecues and the family reunions, were there other events at Reynolda that you remember that brought lots of families together? Or was it mostly kind of people keeping to their own families?
Most of the thing that brought the families together was church. That was the main thing. But I'm just thankful things as well as it is. And I'm gonna tell you all something. Whatever you do, before you start to do anything, look up. He can take care of you. When everything else look bad, he can take care of you. Out here at Reynolda, we lived a good life. Nobody wanted for nothing. Every Thanksgiving, back then we had cold Thanksgivings, my daddy get up, go in the kitchen. We didn't have running water. Get the dipper out of the thing, break the ice in the bucket, get him a drink of water. My mom would have breakfast ready. Turn around, look out, y'all have the fire going when I get home. Okay, but we know that's what he meant. By the time we figured he was gonna get off, we get the fire going out there under the barrel. Go fix 5 gallon barrel. Had a rifle laying out ready with the bullets laying out. He kill that hog. Cleaning everybody in the community. Got a little piece of meat if you want no bigger than your head. That was the first hog killing. And then when it got real cold again, that's when they killed everything. Everybody killed. And if somebody killed and the other one didn't, they got a little piece of meat.
Is it true about the bladder being blown up and played with a soccer ball?
Uh-huh.
Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, we'd do that too.
Can you say it for the camera? Just because I said it in my question, but.
Yeah. Yeah, we load the bladders up, beat them, blow them, beat them some more, and see how big they could get. And then we'd play with them.
Like soccer or football? Or just
anything.
Football?
Most of us throwing it and he batting it.
But was the baseball game a community attraction? Would people come and watch y'all play? Or
once in a while. Most of the thing would be amongst us, just people over and older.
And whom did you play against each other or against other teams?
Yeah, we together, we play on his team today, that team tomorrow. Man, Henry Miller, he always had the ice cream churns out. Yeah, he'd make ice cream. And we got a nickel a comb.
Did you have uniforms for baseball?
Huh?
Did you have a uniform for baseball?
No uniform like that. Do good if you had the gloves and all. But we had a time.
Do you remember anything around Christmas? Any tradition for Christmas?
Well, just the normal things. That was one of the most highly respected holidays it was. Everybody respected Christmas. At one time, you couldn't even buy a gallon of gas on Sunday. That's right. All the stores was closed. Filling station was closed. You didn't do nothing on Sunday. Go to church, go to home and pray. Well, I don't know why. We all turned out to be some big devils as we are. Might as well tell the truth about it.
Is there anything that we didn't ask you that we should have?
Well, something, but I ain't gonna tell you about that vlog. That camera's running and everybody's around. Cause it's something I don't want. Oh, the average one, I'll tell you that it's not so, but it is so. Back when a month or so ago, some things come out about Reynolds. And I looked at them. I said, they don't know what to do with. But if it comes out, they're going to say it ain't so, but it is so.
Something in the news about the company?
No, about the family.
A few months back? If you'd like for us to turn off the camera, we could
turn off the camera. Now turn it off. Don't fake.
All right. Mr. Wharton, we want to thank you for taking the time to talk to us today.
I couldn't say much, but I hope it done you some good. If it made you stop and think 1 minute, it was worth the time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.